Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today on the program, Jill Robbins presents the Education Report. We also hear from John Russell, who has a story about a very old tadpole. And we close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, it's back to Mario.
It would not be autumn without planting advice from Associated Press gardening expert Jessica Damiano. Damiano recently wrote about her experience planting garlic cloves. She was concerned not just about protecting them from low winter temperatures. She was worried that animals would dig up her bulbs and eat them. Tulips, daffodils, and garlic, for example, produce bulbs that bloom in the spring in places that have four seasons and cold winters. To keep away animals, Damiano put netting over the soil and covered it with straw to a thickness of 10 centimeters. She said this is good to do with any bulbs, especially ones like garlic, tulips, and crocuses. That is because animals like to eat the bulbs of these plants. Netting, or a kind of fencing called chicken wire, can serve as a physical barrier that prevents animals from digging up plants. Such barriers do not block sunlight and water from reaching the soil. Damiano said they can be secured to the ground with pieces of wood or rocks. They can be removed in the spring. Straw is a good mulch material that helps keep the temperature of the soil from changing too much. That can help avoid damage to plants caused by freezing and thawing conditions. It also keeps the soil from drying out. Protecting soil is important during the winter when cold, dry weather can damage even the strongest plants. Damiano said it is important to use straw, not hay, in your garden. Hay is animal feed. It contains tall grass, alfalfa, clover, and other seeds that can cause problems in your garden. She said straw is leftover material from crop harvesting. It is better because it has fewer seeds. Damiano also said straw is less likely to contain chemicals used for insect control on crops. Straw is also good for other purposes around your house, the gardening expert noted. Damiano does not like to use some popular fertilizers, such as bone meal, blood meal, or fish fertilizers. She said hungry animals might find such fertilizers appealing. She also advises not to leave parts of bulbs on the ground in your garden because they might be a sign to animals that there is food nearby. There are many products meant to keep away animals that eat bulbs, which include squirrels, rabbits, chipmunks, and others. Damiano does not use repellents because they must be replaced often. She said she does not like doing garden work when it is cold outside. Some repellents can be used to treat bulbs before planting, but she said they wear off over time. Damiano considered a physical barrier, like netting or chicken wire, to be the best defense. But she added, the repellents and other methods can be effective so long as you are diligent.
Scientists in Argentina have discovered the oldest known remains of the tadpole. The animal belonged to a large frog species that lived alongside dinosaurs about 161 million years ago. The researchers said the 16-centimeter-long tadpole died during the larval period, or stage, of frog development. The discovery is providing new information about the development of frogs and toads. The remains suggest tadpoles today are largely unchanged from their ancestors in the ancient time called the Jurassic period. The oldest known frog remains date back even further, though no older tadpole fossils have been found. The remains are in good condition. In fact, researchers say, the ancient tadpole has some soft tissues rarely seen in fossils. The tadpole's eyes and nerves, for example, appear as dark markings in the fossil. Fossil hunters found the tadpole in 2020 during a dig for dinosaur remains on a ranch in the southern province of Santa Cruz. The fossil includes the tadpole's head and most of its body. Frogs have a two-stage life cycle, with the tadpole larva developing into the adult form. This tadpole was in the late stages of development. Adults of this species are a similar length as the tadpole, the researchers said. It's not only the oldest tadpole in the world and amazingly preserved, but it also tells us about the size of one of the few frog species known from that time, said biologist Mariana Chuliver of Fundación Azara Universidad Maimonides. Chuliver was the lead writer of the study that appeared recently in the scientific publication Nature. Chuliver said the soft tissue remains are important because they permit researchers to know the diet and lifestyle of these organisms. The remains, Chuliver added, show that the form and structure of tadpoles have remained almost unchanged over the last 160 million years. I'm John Russell.
First day of seventh grade in Aurora, Colorado, this past August, Allison Ramirez worried about making friends and not understanding lessons taught in English. I was nervous that people would ask me things, and I wouldn't know how to answer, the Venezuelan teen says. And I would be ashamed to answer in Spanish. But it was not what she had expected. Her teachers had translated words from their lessons into Spanish. They gave out written instructions in Spanish. Some teachers even asked in Spanish if students had finished or had questions. That made me feel better, says Allison. The 13-year-old is among the 3,000 new students, mostly from Venezuela and Colombia, at the Aurora public school system. While teachers have been working hard to educate children of immigrants, outside the classrooms, city officials are not as welcoming. They promised not to spend any money helping newcomers and tried to keep them from coming to the area. One city official even claimed that criminals from Venezuela had occupied buildings in Aurora. The police investigated and found it was not true. But the false claim continued to spread. Maria Angel Torres is Allison's mother. The family had left Venezuela to escape lawlessness and violence. They left behind a food truck business after being attacked for not paying protection money. The family then crossed the dangerous Darien Gap on foot to head north and seek asylum in the United States. Torres said she did not believe criminals had taken over buildings. But she worried that bad reports about Venezuelans would affect her and her family. Some organizations and churches wanted to help her family. But others are deeply afraid. Torres told the Associated Press, "I don't look like a threat, but people here act like they feel terrorized." Aurora is used to educating children of immigrants. The 2020 census reported that more than a third of people in Aurora speak a language other than English at home. Immigrants and refugees have been moving to Aurora because it is close to Denver and it has a lower cost of living. However, some schools in the area were not ready for the sudden arrival of many non-English-speaking students from Venezuela and Colombia. Before, a teacher might have had one or two new students in her class. Now, teachers in some schools have as many as 10, or a third of their classroom. Marcela Garcia is the head of Aurora Hills Middle School. She observed that some new students were not talking in classrooms where only English was spoken. So, the school system advised teachers to use a method called translanguaging. That means using Spanish or the home language at times to help new students understand English lessons and discussions happening around them. The method has helped Allison feel more at ease. One day in September, Allison and her friends spoke Spanish among themselves as their teacher spoke to the class in English about a drawing he was showing in front of the class. It was a drawing of an ancient Egyptian marketplace. "What do you think this dude here is doing with the basket?" the teacher asked the class. One girl, who had been in Aurora schools longer than the rest, translated for Allison and the other new students. Before the school began using this new method, teachers may have stopped the new students from talking among themselves. Now they permit students to help each other in any language they can. So far, there appears to be little public criticism in the area against this method. It generally requires more work for teachers, who have to translate materials or their talks in real time. Recently, Allison's mother received messages from Aurora Public Schools that there have been rumors of bomb threats at its schools and others across the state. The schools said there was no truth to the rumors. But that does not make Torres feel better. She said in Venezuela, the country is in trouble, but no one there would think of threatening children at school. I'm Jill Robbins.
You just heard this week's Education Report. Now, Jill Robbins joins me for a chat about her report. Jill, you use a term in the story that I think our audience would like to hear more about. Translanguaging. What can you tell us?
Thanks for asking, Caty. That is a kind of revolutionary concept that has become more widely accepted lately. In the schools I wrote about in this story, teachers let some of the students translate for their classmates when they don't understand something. Or they translate the lesson instructions into Spanish or the home language of the student.
And what do you think of this method?
It seems to be an effective method because it recognizes the knowledge the student has already and uses it to help them adjust to the English-speaking environment.
Is that how you were taught to teach?
Not at all. I was taught that you only use English and you have to draw pictures or use gestures or even do a little song and dance in the class to get across the meaning. But you didn't translate.
Well, I'd love to see you do that song and dance. Thanks for coming on the show.
Anytime, Caty.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our video series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
If you have watched Let's Learn English, you know that Anna has a boss named Ms. Weaver. Ms. Weaver has asked Anna to do some special projects, such as making a children's television show. In Lesson 49 of the series, Ms. Weaver tells Anna to go to a special museum in Washington.
She tells Anna to go to the International Spy Museum and learn about spying.
A spy is a person who collects secret information, or intelligence, about other countries or organizations. The most famous spy in movies is the British agent named James Bond.
The word spy is also a verb. We use the preposition on after the verb spy. So we say that a secret agent, or a spy, spies on other countries.
Andrew, have you ever been to the Spy Museum in Washington, D.C.?
I haven't, but I'd really like to go there. I know you've been there.
I have been there, and it was really cool. Let's listen to the beginning of Lesson 49 and hear Anna talk about her special mission.
It is no secret that Washington, D.C. has spies. Well, it should be a secret, because spying is secret, but it's not a secret. There's even a spy museum. The International Spy Museum has created an amazing collection of spy things. And today, we will see them. My boss, Ms. Weaver, has sent me here on a mission.
Hello, Anna. Are you there?
That's her. Yes, Agent Peacock. This is Agent Flamingo reporting for duty.
Agent what?
Look, Anna, Agent Flamingo. I want you to learn all you can about spying.
You mean collect intelligence?
Yeah, it's for our new show, DC Secret.
You got it, Agent Peacock. The mission is safe with me.
Oh, okay, great. Just
be back by noon.
As you watch Lesson 49, you will learn that Ms. Weaver has a few other reasons for sending Anna to the museum.
And you can notice that Anna used the code names Peacock and Flamingo to talk about herself and Ms. Weaver.
Codes use symbols, numbers, or words to give or get access to secret information. We often use the word security before the word code. For example, to enter some buildings, you must enter a security code, usually a set of numbers.
And spies often try to break codes, or figure out their meaning, to get secret information.
The code names Anna uses, Peacock and Flamingo, are actually the names of two types of large birds. Now, let's listen to the first thing Anna tries to do at the spy museum.
Agent Peacock, I'm at an air duct.
Yes, spies sometimes sneak down air ducts.
I have never snuck down an air duct. It's dark and small. I'm afraid of dark, small places.
You can do it, Agent Flamingo. You know, spies aren't afraid of a little darkness.
As you heard in one of our recent podcasts, Anna is using the present perfect tense. To make that tense, Anna used the past participle form of the verb sneak, which is snuck here. Andrew, did you know the past tense form and the past participle form can be either sneaked or snuck?
You know, when I watched the video and I heard her say sneaked, it made me think about that. And I realized, sometimes we say have snuck, sometimes we say have sneaked.
Before the late 1800s, only sneaked was considered correct. But gradually people accepted snuck. Anyway, an air duct carries cooling air or heat through a building. A person can fit inside of it, but must crawl to move through it, because air ducts are usually only about 1 meter wide and 1 meter high.
The verb sneak means to move around secretly. Listen to these prepositions that usually follow the verb sneak.
I'm going to sneak in the movie theater. I'm going to sneak in to the movie theater. They snuck around the office building.
When we go in a room without permission, we sneak in or sneak into. When we walk through more than one room or through a larger area, we sometimes say sneak around. And when we secretly go through a narrow area, we sneak down.
At Christmas time, children often sneak downstairs to see what's under the tree for them. So Anna sneaks down the air duct.
Yes, spies sometimes sneak down air ducts.
And this reminds me, in the Christmas holiday tradition, Santa Claus sneaks down the chimneys of houses to bring presents to children.
But then he has to climb back up the chimney. I think I would have trouble doing that.
Yeah, me too. But let's listen and see if Anna has trouble sneaking down the air duct.
I have never snuck down an air duct. It's dark and small. I'm afraid of dark, small places.
You can do it, Agent Flamingo. You know, spies aren't afraid of a little darkness.
Right. It's just an air duct. Dark, small air duct. Okay, I'm doing it, Agent Peacock. I am sneaking down a long, dark, small air duct. I'm having a little trouble breathing.
Just keep going, Agent Flamingo. Think of the team.
Okay, I will think of the team. I'm thinking of the team, Agent Peacock. I did it! I did it! I sneaked down an air duct. That was a little uncomfortable.
Good.
Anna was able to sneak down the air duct, but she had a little trouble breathing because she was nervous.
When we say we have trouble doing something, we mean that it is difficult for us to do.
And here are rules for using that expression. We use the preposition with when a noun follows have trouble. For example, students can say they are having trouble with their homework.
And if we use a verb after have trouble, we must use the gerund or ing form of the verb. So we can say the students are having trouble doing their homework.
I also noticed that Ms. Weaver and Anna both used the expression afraid of. Because the word of is a preposition, if we use a verb after it, that verb must also use the gerund or ing form of the verb.
For example, if you are having some big problems with a friend, you might say you are afraid of losing your friendship.
And the expression scared of means the same thing as afraid of. Anna said she is afraid of dark, small places. Listeners, what kinds of places or situations are you afraid of? Write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com and let us know.
Andrew, before we go, we should find out what other reasons Miss Weaver had for sending Anna to the museum.
One reason that you can learn when you watch the video is simply to make Anna try to do some difficult things, like hanging from a bar, breaking a code, or crawling through a small space. But the other reason is connected to Ms. Weaver's stomach.
Her stomach?
Yes. Let's listen.
The International Spy Museum is awesome! Agent Peacock, I completed the mission.
Great, great.
Now, I have another very important mission for you.
Got it. See you back at HQ.
Yummy! You brought my lunch. Thanks, Agent Flamingo.
Mission completed, Agent Peacock.
Ah, Ms. Weaver gave Anna the mission of bringing her lunch. Maybe that's because the spy museum is near some good restaurants.
Maybe so.
And HQ is short for headquarters. In this case, HQ is the office where Ms. Weaver works.
Yes, and bringing lunch is not exactly a spy mission, but as we know, Anna has a big imagination.
Well, now I'm getting hungry for my own lunch, so it's time to say goodbye for now. We hope you've enjoyed this lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And don't forget to write to us. And remember that you can find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. I'm Andrew Smith.
Our show for today, but join us again tomorrow to keep learning English on the Voice of America. I'm Caty Weaver.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.